Kingdom greetings to us all. My name is Pastor Nyasha Ziswa. Together with my husband, we are regional pastors at Highlands Chisipiti District here in Harare. I would like to appreciate and honor my spiritual parents, Professor Ezekiel H. Guti, together with my mother, Dr. Eunor Guti, for this great opportunity to be sharing on this platform. Today, I'm going to be sharing a message impressed upon my heart by the Holy Spirit entitled, The Authority of the Spoken Word. This message is also inspired by the book written by our Father under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Integrity of God's Word. Allow me to pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this moment now. We give you all the glory. Holy Spirit, take over. Open our spiritual ears that we may hear from you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Now, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion man came to him, pleading with him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes. To another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this. May God bless the reading of his word. The book of Matthew was written by Matthew, a former tax collector who became a disciple of Jesus. Matthew wrote this book to his fellow Jewish statesmen to convince them that Jesus was the long-awaited Messiah who had brought with him the kingdom of God. Now, in chapter 1 and 2, we read about the genealogy, the birth, and the childhood of Jesus Christ. In chapter 3, we see Jesus being baptized in water and being filled with the Holy Spirit. In chapter 4, we learn about Jesus' private ministry of prayer and fasting in preparation of his public ministry. From chapter 5 to 7, Jesus delivers the Sermon on the Mount, outlining the principles of the kingdom of God. Now, when we get to chapter 8, Jesus begins to demonstrate the kingdom of God by healing sickness and disease, by delivering those who are oppressed by devils, and by even commanding storms to calm. Now, in chapter 8, where we have read, we hear the story of the centurion man. The centurion was a Roman soldier who had authority over 100 other army officers. At the time, Israel was a colony of Rome. And as such, the Roman Empire would deploy a centurion who was responsible of maintaining peace and order in the colony. Now, this man, he was a man of authority, but he also had senior other officers that he reported to and ultimately to Caesar himself. So when he exercised his authority, he exercised his authority by speaking a word of command, like he said, come, go, do this to his servant, and they would obey. Now, his words had authority because they were being backed by the Roman government. His words were underpinned by the Roman law itself. So when he spoke, people would obey him, not because of his appearance or his stature, but it would have been as if Caesar himself was speaking. So they were obeying the authority that he represented. They were obeying Caesar himself. Now, with all that authority and all that power, this man, he had a problem. The Bible says that his servant was paralyzed and tormented and sick at home. And so he approaches Jesus. He realizes that with all that power, though he had authority, his authority was not working in the situation he was in. He was limited. This situation was beyond his jurisdiction. So he needed a different kind of authority. So when he goes to Jesus, he approaches Jesus as a man of higher authority, submitting himself to the authority of Christ. An authority that was able to give marching orders to sickness and disease, and they would go. An authority that was able to command evil spirits to go, and they would obey. An authority that was able to speak to weather systems, and storms would come immediately. So he goes to the man Jesus Christ. You know, sometimes in life, when we go through challenges, we need to recognize and know the authority that is able to help us. Sometimes we disadvantage ourselves, you know, by trying to deal with issues with our own limited human understanding, things that are beyond our control. Yet there is an authority by the name Jesus Christ that can easily step in and solve our issues. Now, when we go back to the story, Jesus hears the plight of this servant, and I believe he's moved with compassion. And then he says to the centurion, you know what? I'm willing. He was even willing to make the trip to the house where the servant was. But the centurion man who understood the power of the spoken word, this man understood the authority behind the spoken word, that if Jesus speaks, he believed in the power of the word of God. So he says, Lord, Master, don't even bother coming to my house. I'm not even worth for that. Just speak a word and my servant will be healed. Now, our father in the book Integrity of God's Word on page 8, he writes and he says, the word has the same authority as he would have if he were to appear before us. I'll take it again. The word of God has the same authority as he would have if he were to appear before us. Now, the servant of this centurion is at home, paralyzed, sick to the point of death. But Jesus is somewhere else, at a different location. But because of his understanding of the authority of the spoken word, Jesus just speaks a word and releases a word of healing. That word travels to where this servant was at home. And this servant is healed right there and then, as if Jesus was present with him in the room. Our Father says, the word has the same authority as it would have if he were to appear before us. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. The power of the spoken word. Now, God has spoken. And God is still speaking to us. He speaks through to us through the word of God, through the written word of God. So it is my responsibility to read the word of God, meditate on the word of God, and then speak the word of God back into my life. I want to submit to us, ladies and gentlemen, when we engage the word of God in our lives, it has the same authority. It has the power to do its work, just as if Jesus is right there with you in that situation. Now, John chapter 1, verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Who he? He, the Word, was there in the beginning with God. And all things were made through him, the Word. And without him, nothing was made that was made. The Word of God, it was there in the beginning, before the beginning of creation, which means it existed before the creation was made. The word of God is supreme to all creation. Now it says, and the Word was God. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. So God is His Word. And His Word is God. So God equates Himself to His Word. He says, I am my Word. He is His Word. So when we speak the Word of God, God backs His Word. That Word has power and authority because God backs it. Our Father says that the heaven backs the Word. God Himself, He supports His Word. He underpins His Word. He is the guarantor of His Word. All heaven backs the Word. The throne of God backs the Word. So when we speak and declare the Word of God, it has the power. It has the ability. And it has the authority to change a situation, to address a situation. Whilst my situation, it cannot change the Word of God, but it is the Word of God that I need in a situation in order to change that situation. So I believe as we speak the Word of God in a situation, you are speaking God in it. You are inviting the presence of God into that situation. It's as if God steps in. It's as if God shows up and He shows off the glory of His Word. Hallelujah. Now, I remember about 3 years ago, we had a family situation. My father was diagnosed with prostate cancer, and he went through some radiation treatment. So some time later after that treatment, he developed a complication whereby he could not empty his bladder. So he would have these episodes, and time and again, he would have to be placed on a catheter. And it got to a point where he had to have this catheter on for an extended period of time. And after speaking to the doctors, seeing what options were available to assist him, what they said is, whatever we do, the end result is going to be the same. We don't really have much hope. He is going to be incontinent for the rest of his life. So we realized that there was nothing these people could do for us. What we needed was a miracle. And so what I did, I got copies of this book by our father, A Life of Miracles. We really needed to read, what God has done through this ministry, what God has done in His Word, and to encourage us and to stir up our faith. And also remembering the teachings of our mother, she always teaches us that when you pray the Word of God. So I understood that it was important that we apply the Word of God. So we went on ahead and downloaded as many scriptures on healing as we could and just shared them amongst us. And we said, we're going to use the Word of God. So what I personally went on ahead and did was every morning, I would send an audio recording declaring and speak the Word of God. And I'll say, good morning, Dad. How are you today? Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him. And by His stripes, we are healed. By His stripes, Daddy, you are healed. And I send it off. Next day, Psalms 107, verse 20. And He sent His Word, and it healed them and delivered them from all their destructions. I'm sending a word of healing right now in Jesus' name. The next day, Jeremiah 32, 27, behold, I'm the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? And I say, Lord, there is nothing too hard for the Lord. You are going to be healed. Receive your healing. God is healing you right now. Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. And Jesus went about all Galilee. He was preaching in the synagogue, teaching the kingdom of God, healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of diseases. Oh, even this situation, God is going to heal you. Amen. So we went on and did that day after day. So they said to him, come back after a month and we'll just do what we can do. And when he went there to run a test, and I tell you, God did a miracle. As we were praying that month, declaring the word of God, believing God, raising our faith to God, God did the miracle and restored him, restored his health. Even up to now, 3 years later, God has healed him to the glory of God. I want to say to us today, what is our situation? What is your healing? I want to encourage you to engage the word of God and speak the word of God. Find out, what does the word of God say about my situation? I like what Jesus did. You know, when he was at his lowest moment, being tempted by the enemy in the wilderness, Jesus began to address and to respond to the situation using the word of God. And he said, "It is written." And then again the enemy came and he responded, "It is written." Each time the enemy tried to play tricks on him, he would go on and say, "It is written in the word of God." So my job, my responsibility is to find out, what is it written about? What is written about the situation that I'm going through? Because the word of God, it addresses everything pertaining to our life. Our Father says our healing is in the word of God. Our deliverance is in the word of God. My provision is in the word of God. My victory is in the word of God. Everything that I may want and desire, it is in the word of God. And there is no situation that the word of God cannot address. And I believe that there is no situation that can resist the word of God. Why? Because of the authority that is behind that word, God himself. Now in Mark chapter 11 verse 24, from verse 14 to 24, we know the story. Jesus is coming from Bethany, going to Jerusalem. And as he's on his journey, he is hungry and he sees a fig tree and he wants to go and take some fruit from it. So when he gets to the place, to the tree, he finds that this tree has no fruit. So Jesus speaks some profound words and he says to it, "Let no one eat fruit from you ever again." And he proceeded. So when he spoke that word, in verse 14, the Bible says the disciples heard it. And now on the following morning, they're coming back on their journey. And Peter, remembering, seeing the tree, fig tree, he says, "Master, look, that tree which you cast yesterday, it's dried up to the roots." Now I want to say to us, the disciples heard what Jesus said. But it wasn't only the disciples who heard it. The tree also heard what Jesus said. And not only the tree did the tree hear, but the tree obeyed what Jesus said. Because the following morning, it was dried up to the roots. And Jesus goes on to say, "Have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain," whoever speaks to this mountain and he says, "Be removed and be cast into the sea," and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that whatever he says, whatever he speaks, it shall be done, and he will have whatever he says. The question this morning is, what are we saying to our situations? What are we saying about circumstances that are not pleasant in our lives? What are we saying? Are we just crying over it, saying how impossible it is, talking, just compounding the negative situation by our negative words and how hard and how we will never get out of this situation? But ladies and gentlemen, I want to say to us, I want to encourage us this morning. I want to beseech us this morning. Let us begin to confess the word of God. Let us begin to confess the same way God would speak to that situation. Let's speak the same. Let's speak the word of God. Speak to that mountain. It has ears to hear. That situation has ears to hear. That tree, that obstacle, it has ears to hear. And it does what we say. So we need to speak the word of God. Now, in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 37, we hear the story of Ezekiel. Ezekiel is in the middle of a valley with dry bones. It is lifeless. There is no future. Nothing good can come out of that situation. Ezekiel is probably looking at it and he's saying, there is no hope in this valley, and he's crying to himself. But then the word of God comes to Ezekiel, and God poses a question to Ezekiel. Ezekiel, can these dry bones live again? Oh, thank God it was Ezekiel that was asked. I probably would have said, Lord, no, they cannot live. But Ezekiel says, oh God, you know. And God says to Ezekiel, son of man, prophesy to those dry bones. Prophesy and say, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. It wasn't any other word that the dry bones were supposed to hear, but they were supposed to hear the word of the Lord. And the dry bones heard the word of the Lord that Ezekiel spoke. I want to say to us this morning, what is the problem that you're going through? What is your situation and your circumstance? Say to that situation, hear the word of the Lord. Are you struggling in your finances? I want you to speak to the situation, and you need God to do a miracle and say, you situation, you finances, hear the word of the Lord. For at the mountain of God, it shall be provided. Jehovah Jireh is his name. I want you to speak to your situation. Are you sick in your body? Are you sick in your body? Speak to that sickness. Speak to that disease and say, you sickness, hear the word of the Lord. By his stripes I am healed. Is your marriage falling apart today? I want you to speak the word of the Lord to that marriage and say to it, what God has joined, let no man put asunder. Declare the kingdom of God and say, righteousness, peace, and joy of the Holy Ghost. Are your children giving you trouble today? I want you to prophesy the word of God over their lives and say, you children, you shall be taught of the Lord. What are you going through today? Is your business falling apart? I want you to speak the word of the Lord and say, the works of my hands, they are blessed. Hallelujah. Rabakasata raboshienda. Speak the word of God. Speak the word of God. I remember about a month ago, I came down sick with COVID-19. I remember when I had that diagnosis, I was very afraid. I was fearful and I was in isolation. I didn't know how it was going to end. But I remember our father, Professor E.H. Guti, praying for me. And he spoke some words and he said, Nyasha, I rebuke fear. I rebuke the spirit of fear. Do not fear. And he spoke healing into my life. So at that time, I realized that fear was my enemy. I was literally, coming down with fear more than the disease itself, because of what I'd heard about what it can do, what it was doing. And so I was so afraid, but I began to say, Lord, help me. And I began to look in the word of God. And I said in Psalms 27 verse 1, I would just declare and say, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of what shall I be afraid of? When my enemies came up to eat my flesh, to eat my enemies and my foe, they stumbled and fell. I would continue to declare the word of the Lord and say Psalms 34 from verse 4, that I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. For they looked to him and were radiant and their faces were not ashamed. I would continue to declare and say, the angel of the Lord, it encamps all those around who fear him. And as I was going through that period of isolation, sometimes I didn't have
have the strength to read or to speak, but I would just play the audio. I made it a point that the word of God just plays in the background so that my spirit can feed on the word of God. And I believe that it was through those prayers, through the word of God, that God restored my health. Hallelujah. There is power in the word of God. There is power in the word of God. John goes on to say in John 1 verse 14 that the word of God, it became flesh and it dwelt among us. Talking of Jesus Christ, that Jesus is his word who became flesh. You know, the word of God, it can manifest. It can manifest in your life. It can manifest in your situation. It doesn't matter what the situation is like. It's beyond repair. It's beyond human wisdom. It's beyond human understanding. But that's where God steps in. When we invite him through the word of God, Jesus himself, he manifests, and in his glory, John says, and we beheld his glory. I believe that the word of God, when it comes into a situation, when it manifests, it becomes glorious. The book of Acts 19 verse 20, he goes on to say, look, that the word of God grew mightily. It grew mightily and it prevailed. The word of God, when it comes into a situation, it will grow. As it continues to grow, it will prevail. It will prevail against that situation. I want to encourage us this morning. I want to speak to someone this morning that do not lose hope. Do not lose courage. Do not lose hope. Be bold in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. Because God has given us his word as a weapon. God has given us his word as a tool so we can prevail. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword, piercing right through to the bone and marrow, division of soul and spirit. Power in the word of God. Rabba sata rabo shienda namakaya. Rebo kosanda namakaya. Isaiah 55 from verse 10. God begins to speak again about his word. And he says, just as the rain comes and waters the earth, the snow comes and waters the earth and causes it to bud and to bring forth, to give bread to the eater and seed to the sower, so is my word from my mouth. So is the word of God from his mouth. It will not return to him void. It will not return to him empty, but it will accomplish what he pleases. It will accomplish what he pleases, and it will prosper. The word of God will prosper. It can never fail. Heaven and earth may fail. Heaven and earth may pass away, but his word remains forever. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Someone is saying, Nyasha, how can I apply the word of God in my life? How can I speak the word of God with such power and authority? You know, I learned something from the centurion man. He said, I'm a man under authority, which means as long as he submitted himself to the rulership of Caesar, he continued to have authority over his 100 men. When he then speaks to them and he says, you go, come, do this, this man would obey. Why? Because he was submitted to Caesar. He had the backing of Caesar. He had a relationship with Caesar. Our Father continuously speaks about having a good relationship with God. Having a good relationship with God. And he says that the kingdom of God is the rulership of God in the hearts of the believer. So we need to have a relationship. Allow God to rule in our lives. Allow God to rule in our lives. When you look at his life, our father, Professor E. H. Goody's life, I marvel. I marvel. I'm like, wow. Look at his life, how obedient he is to God, how humble he is to God. When you hear our father speaks, Baba Guti, he says, I am a servant of God. I don't do what I want. He does what God does, what God wants him to do. You know, earlier on this year, We all know, most of us do know that, you know, he left his nice home in obedience to God and went to a small town outside of the capital to do in obedience to what God has commanded him. Such level of obedience that he waits on God to tell him every step and every move that he should make. And I believe that even though it's sometimes not comfortable, but he obeys God. So because of that obedience, look at the authority that our Father has. You know, when he speaks, things do happen. When he speaks, things come to pass. God has entrusted him to lead this ministry to over 154 nations and states. He is a man under the authority of God, yet he is a man of great authority himself. Why? Because of his relationship with God. What are we saying, ladies and gentlemen? For us to be able to speak and to declare the word of God and see it manifest and become flesh, I need to have a relationship with God. I need to be connected. I need the rulership of God in my life. I need to be in the kingdom of God. And as I do that, when I release the word, the Lord will say, yes, I'm backing my word, because this one is a centurion, is part of my kingdom, is part of my empire. So I'm backing that word. Hallelujah. Having a relationship with God is very important. Now Jesus says in Mark 11 verse 24, he says, when you speak the word, do not doubt but believe in your heart. I want to submit to us today, ladies and gentlemen, that we have no reason to doubt the word of God. We have no excuse to doubt the word of God. I need to work on myself to believe. You know, faith comes by hearing. Even the faith to believe, it comes from the word of God. So I need to dwell in the word of God so that I believe it and I don't doubt it. You know, in Numbers chapter 23, God says, I'm not a man that I should lie, neither my son of man that I should repent from what I have said. Have I not spoken? Will I not make it good? Which means when God speaks, we don't have a reason to doubt, because that's the integrity of God's word. He does not lie. He does not change and say, make a promise, like I can make a promise to you and tomorrow I say, oh, sorry, my friend, I was just joking, I've changed my mind. No, he's not like that. When he speaks, he means it. When he speaks, he means it. He will not lie. So the word of God has integrity. Do not doubt his word. Do not doubt. If God says, I'll provide for you, he will provide for you. Hallelujah. Now, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4:13, he says, and since we have the same spirit of faith, as it is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. He says, we believe and we therefore speak. I want to encourage us this day that speak the word of God. The word of God that you believe, don't keep it silent, but speak it, declare it, declare it, declare the word of God. And as you declare the word of God, I believe that the word of God will manifest and do what it says it will do. Are you here this morning and you are not feeling well in your body? I want to speak a word of healing. Raise up your faith today and believe God for healing in your body. The word of God says that he was bruised for our iniquities. He was wounded for our transgressions. The chastisement for our sins was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. So I speak healing right now. I speak healing right now to your body. I speak healing right now. I command that sickness in your body. As I say, your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Sickness, you are not allowed. Sickness, you cannot trespass. So I command you to go in Jesus' name. Leave in Jesus' name. Cancer, I command you to go in Jesus' name. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Back pain, I command you to leave in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Are you here this morning? You are believing God for a breakthrough. God is well able to do it for you. He is the God of the impossible. With God, nothing shall be impossible. With men, it is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. He is a God who can break through for you like many waters. He is a God who makes a way where there is no way. Raise your faith and declare the word of God. Are you tormented by spirits this morning? I speak a word of deliverance and I say, be set free. Be set free, for he who the Son of Man sets free is free indeed. For this reason, the Son of Man was manifest to destroy the works of the devil. Be set free right now. Be set free right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, receive your healing. Receive your deliverance. Receive your breakthrough. Receive your breakthrough in Jesus' mighty name. I pray. Amen. Glory to Jesus. Now, for this word of God to have an effect in your life, like we already said, you need to have a relationship with God. John chapter 1, verse 12, it says, to they that received him, he gave them the power, the right, the authority to be called children of God. And in Romans chapter 9, chapter 10, verse 8 to 9, it says, for the word is near you. The word is near you. It's in your mouth. It's in your heart. The word of faith that we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that he was raised from the dead, you will be saved. So I want you to repeat this prayer after me. Mean it from all your heart, from the depth of your heart. It is a prayer that will permanently change your life today. So raise your hands where you are right now and repeat after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I've heard your word. I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I believe, Jesus, that you died and rose again on the third day. Jesus, I open my heart. Come into my heart. Forgive me of all my sins. Serve my soul. Lord Jesus, I confess you now as my Lord and personal Savior. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Congratulations to you, my friend. If you've prayed that prayer, you are now a child of God. Welcome to the family of God. I want you to contact the numbers on our screen. Go on our website. There is someone there ready to help you and direct you to the Forward in Faith Church nearest to you. We love you. God loves you. And God bless you.